Up to now, we've been talking about magnitudes small m, which are essentially what we would call apparent magnitudes. Now, these apparent magnitudes will depend on the distance. If the same object is further away from you, it will look fainter, so the magnitude is going to be higher. And if it is closer, it will appear brighter, so the magnitude will be lower. Now, there is a magnitude that does not depend on distance that is called the absolute magnitude that you see here. This is denoted with a capital M. And the way that we define absolute magnitudes is as the apparent magnitude when the source is at 10 parsec away from us. So this is the definition. Because of this definition and the way that we could write, say, go back to the Vigo definition. So in the Vigo definition, a magnitude would just be the flux in SI. So the flux is luminosity divided by 4 pi luminosity distance plus a 0 point. All we're saying is that an absolute magnitude is exactly the same, but we know the distance is 10 parsec. For this reason, if you actually look at the difference between absolute magnitude and the apparent magnitude, it will be given by minus 2.5 log 10 d squared over 10 squared. This also means that you can rewrite this and end up with an equation that looks like this. Right? So all you're doing is you're using logarithmic properties to take out the 10 and then putting it as a 5. And ultimately, sometimes it is useful to write it explicitly so that if you calculate the apparent magnitude and you calculate a distance, you get the absolute magnitude of a source. Or the other way, which is to remember the relation between distance and parallax angle and parsec, to ultimately write an expression where you can get absolute magnitude in terms of apparent magnitude and the parallax angle. Deriving it is relatively simple. All you had to know was how to convert a distance to a parallax angle and also to use the properties of logarithms. Provided you do that, you don't need to memorize all these equations. Perhaps the most important one is really this. And you will find some of these in the important equations that you need to remember so that 263 feels much easier. Now, because of what we've just seen, then the difference between the apparent magnitude and the absolute magnitude is in a way just a function of distance to the source. That's what sets the difference in value of the apparent magnitude and the absolute magnitude. Because of that, this quantity, m minus m, is actually defined as what is called the distance modulus. So it's essentially the logarithm of the distance in parsec times 5. And sometimes you want to calculate even larger distances. So you may want to transform it into megaparsec by essentially adding 25, while here, remember, you would be subtracting 5. This comes out from how we defined absolute magnitude. And the application of this is that sometimes, because we want an absolute magnitude, what we actually need is a distance modulus. And if you subtract a distance modulus from an apparent magnitude, you get the absolute magnitude directly. And this might come in handy when we look at stars or distant galaxies. And if we want to actually solve for the distance in megaparsec, say, you would use an equation that looks pretty much like this. There is, of course, no need to memorize all the equations, but I think most importantly, you should understand where they come from and also how simple it is to derive them, provided that you understand what an absolute magnitude and an apparent magnitude is. As a final example of just applying some of these concepts and the distance modulus is to use a Levitt law. This is related with what we can see here on the right. And this was a discovery from Henrietta Levitt that showed that if you measure the periods of these C-fate variables, their variable stars where their apparent magnitude changes and where their actually absolute magnitude also changes and reaches some peak, but that peak is actually very nicely correlated with the periods. So if you actually measure the periods, you can have access to the peak absolute magnitude. And if you are to compare it with the apparent magnitude, you can get some proxy of a distance. So in terms of international units, this is how the relation is stated. But more interestingly, just to use the quantities we defined, there's a relation between the absolute magnitude that you can see here and the period in days. So let's say that we want to apply this, and we'll come back to this when we cover a little bit more about other galaxies and a little bit of observational cosmology. This is something you may cover as well in cosmology one. But for now, let's say that you have this relation over here, and then we're just applying it. And let's say that we want to measure a distance to a C-phase star in some source that has some apparent peak magnitude of 17 in the V-band and has a period of 10 days. So to do this, what you can do is use this expression over here. You would plug in the 10 days into the expression so that you can find out that you would expect that C-phase variable to have a peak of minus 4.2 in absolute magnitudes. And then you can use the expression for the distance modulus to find out that it would be 21.2. And then you can even convert it into megaparsec. And this would be a very nice, neat way in which you're using some observables, a period, and apparent magnitude to find out how far away a specific C-phase star is or was. So this is it for section 4. I hope that by the end of it, and hopefully by reading a little bit more into the lecture notes and specifically challenging yourself in section 4.4, you become familiar with all these concepts so that even though some of them can be challenging and weird, like magnitudes, you understand how they are defined and how to operate them. And if you have any questions, please just get in touch. Feel free to email me or get in touch via Teams. And if you're done with all the section and the problems and everything is clear, then I'll see you for section 5.